Dylan, I just want to thank you so much for this time you've given us where we as a fellowship can come together and worship your name. I thank you for this past week and all the things that you've done, and next week and all the things you are going to do, Lord. I pray that even amidst this time where we're all separate and apart, Lord, I pray that we wouldn't stop seeing how you're moving, Lord. And I pray that we would be sensitive to that tonight, Lord. I pray that as we worship you, you would be pleased, Lord. And yeah, just gonna pray, amen.
My sin upon that cross. together worthy, all together wonderful to me. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
Nothing is holding me back from you.
the King upon your throne. Thank you for the way you always loved me. Now I get to love you in return. Now I get to love you in return.
God, I thank you that we can sing and worship you, and that you love to hear us sing to you, God. It's an honor to get to praise you, Lord, and it's an honor to know that your presence is with us when we say your name. And yeah, Lord, I just ask what these songs have said. I first and foremost thank you for your Son, and I thank you for your gospel that is now our life. And Lord, I pray that you would be the center of everything we do. I pray that you would be the center of our lives. I pray that you would be the center of your church. And I pray that we could pray these things earnestly and with desperation, because we can't do anything apart from you. And so, Lord, as we continue on with this large group, I pray that you would be pleased, and that your presence, and I thank you, Lord, that your presence will continue to stay with us. I pray for our speaker, Mr. Kwan, Victor Kwan. I pray that you would give him the grace to speak the things that you place on his heart, and those things only, God. And I pray that you would be ministering to him, that blessings may overflow. And we love you, Lord, and in your Son's name I pray, amen.
Yeah, we'd like to welcome Victor Kwan. Thank you for coming to speak to us. He is currently the staffer of the regional AACF chapter in the Bay Area, essentially, of UOP, SFSU, and San Jose State. So he's also is on staff with AACF, so I'd like to welcome him, and thank you for bringing a message to us for us to listen to and discuss later. So take it away.
All right. Thank you very much. And let me see here. Okay. Press that button and this button and the present button. Okay. So yes, thanks for inviting me to be a part of your meeting tonight. And I was telling the group beforehand that I've always enjoyed coming down the slow. Sometimes I'm going down the slow, sometimes I'm coming up the slow, because I've been down in SoCal and I swing by on the way back home. But always enjoy going there. When two of my kids were younger, they went with me to the Cal Poly retreat. You guys still go to Lopez Lake? Yeah, okay. That place is strange, because I followed the directions and takes you down this dark mountain road, and I'm going, okay, God, I'm going to follow these directions. And yeah, finally, we found this campsite. But my kids, I think they spent more time with the students there than I did. And so every time I wanted to, or every time I spoke at SLO, they wanted to come with me. I mean, that's like 10 years ago now. They've already graduated. Some of you may know Austin. He graduated from UCI last year, and he seems to know a lot of people in the different AACFs. So anyway, sorry I can't be there this time, but always enjoy having fellowship with the folks at SLO. And greetings from San Jose State, SF State, and UOP. We meet on Monday nights, and we've been having a good time getting to know each other and fellowshipping with each other. All right, so tonight I want to share with you this topic, sharing the gospel during the pandemic. Okay, and the reason I wanted to share that with you is because I understand that you're interested in the why question this semester. And my question is, why are we not sharing the gospel during the pandemic? I think a lot of times when I talk to people, like ever since March, we've come under the impression that we got to put sharing the gospel on hold, because there's no way we can do that on Zoom, and there's no way we can lead people to Christ And so, yeah, we're just going to put that on the back burner and wait till the pandemic is over. But yeah, my question is why? You know, why should we wait? Why are we not sharing the gospel as much as we might normally do so when we're on campus? So let's take a look at that question tonight. And, you know, there are some obstacles. We have to be honest about it. There are some challenges in sharing our faith during the pandemic. And, you know, one of them is the lack of personal live contact. And I understand down in SLO, the pandemic is not as bad as it is in other parts of the state or, you know, even the nation right now. But still, some of you are in SLO. Some of you are probably in SoCal. Maybe some of you are in NorCal. I don't know if anybody is out of the country or not. UOP had one student who went back to Taiwan. And I heard last semester she was taking classes at 1 a.m. But, you know, the pandemic has minimized, you know, live personal contact. So that's a challenge. And then there's this awkwardness of Zoom. If we're all together in one room, we can have like 5 or 6 conversations going on at the same time. But when you're on Zoom, normally there's only one person talking. And, you know, I'm talking right now. And if you start talking and you don't, if you're not muted, I can hear you talking. I'll stop talking to hear what you're saying. And so, yeah, there's this awkwardness of having conversations on Zoom. And yeah, people are just zoomed out. You know, high school students, elementary school students, and, you know, college students. Last spring semester, I was talking to the core group at San Jose State, and I was asking them how the Zoom meetings were going. And one of the core members asked me, can we not have speakers? And I said, why is that? He said, because every time we have a speaker, it feels like we're sitting in another class. I go, yeah, okay, I get it. And yeah, people are, you know, just zoomed out. And, you know, there's that feeling of being defeated by the pandemic. And, you know, the pandemic has us down. And sharing the gospel is just not something that we can possibly do. But I want you to think about some of the stories in scripture. Back in July, we had a guest speaker at our church, and he was talking about Jonah. And, you know, everybody knows Jonah as the prophet who got swallowed by this whale or, you know, a large fish, and he got barfed back up on the beach. And, you know, that's what we know about Jonah. But, you know, he was a reluctant prophet, not just because he was trying to run away from the appointment God had given to him. But when he got to Nineveh, he had no expectation that the people would listen to his message. And when you read chapter 3 of Jonah, you have to not just read the words, you have to hear how Jonah is preaching. You know, it says he had this message about repent. And, you know, I could just imagine how excited he was going through Nineveh preaching this message. Repent. Repent. I said it again. Repent. And, you know, that's probably the excitement level that he had. But, you know, what happened there? It says that there was a revival in the whole city of Nineveh. And the people listened to the words that Jonah was giving, and they repented of their sin. And there was this mini revival that went on in the city of Nineveh. So our guest speaker was sharing about that. And I go, you know, that's amazing, because there are all kinds of barriers there for people to come to know God. And yet God worked through a reluctant prophet, worked through a unmotivated message, and was still able to bring people into his kingdom. And so it made me think about other situations in scripture where it was difficult, if not impossible, to share the gospel. So I thought of a couple others, and here's one of them. You might remember Paul and Silas in prison. They're chained, they're locked up, they're with other prisoners. It's smelly, it's dark, it's dank. Just a lousy place to be sharing your faith. But what do Paul and Silas do? They start singing worship songs, and the whole place starts rocking and shaking. And at the end of the night, the Philippian jailer and his entire family had come to know Christ. And so I go, yeah, you know, two guys locked in prison, that's pretty bad. And still God worked through that and, you know, brought this Roman citizen, you know, this Philippian jailer into the kingdom, you know, him and his entire family. And then, of course, maybe the hardest situation was when Jesus was dying on the cross. And, you know, nobody would have blamed Jesus if he had, you know, simply died. And, you know, he would have saved us from our sins and he would have accomplished his purpose. But in the midst of his death, he turns to the thief on the cross next to him and says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." And so Jesus was leading people into his kingdom, even at the point of death. And so I look at those three scenarios and how bad they were and how hopeless they were for someone to come to receive the gospel message. And yet it happened. And so it makes me consider, if it can happen in those places, it can certainly happen during the pandemic. And so that's what I want to encourage us with tonight, that the gospel is still powerful during the pandemic. And, you know, God is not sheltered in place. And it's okay for Jesus to touch you. I preached a message probably back in April about the lepers. And you know how lepers, when they would walk down the street, they had to say, "Unclean, unclean." And I told our congregation, you know what? We're all lepers right now. Because when we walk down the street, and if someone else is coming at us, you know, we don't say unclean, but, you know, one of us has to walk off the sidewalk and walk out into the street to avoid, you know, passing each other. So in some sense, we're saying unclean, unclean. And yeah, you know, we're all like lepers. But see, it's okay for Jesus to touch us. If Jesus reaches out and touches us or touches our lives, touches the life of a friend, it's okay. We're not going to get infected. It's okay for Jesus to touch us. And then finally, you know, the Holy Spirit can still breathe on you. Wow. You know, do you want someone breathing on you right now? You know, I was watching the End of the World series the other night, and you know, they showed Justin Turner out there with the rest of the team, and he had tested positive, and he's probably the last person I would have wanted to touch that night. But, you know, the Holy Spirit can touch me anytime he wants, because I know it's okay for him to breathe on me, and it's okay for me to be in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And so, you know, that should encourage us to know that, you know, God is still working during the time of the pandemic. All right, so what are some ways to create venues for sharing the gospel? You know, first of all, we can talk about the gospel and the pandemic. I know at the beginning, you know, back in March and April, you know, people were wondering, how long is it going to last? You know, what do we do? You know, some people were just they were horrified as to what we can be doing during the pandemic. And, you know, there are ways for us to dialogue with people and to discuss the pandemic and to let them know how the gospel speaks into that. Just recently, I began to realize how many parallels there are between the pandemic and the exile. And I'm trying to develop some things about that. And, you know, once I get that done, maybe I can pass that on to you. But, you know, just think about the exile. When people were exiled off to Babylon, the temple had been burned. They were cut off from worshiping. They were in a land that was strange to them. They could not see people that they were used to seeing. And they were being influenced by another culture. You know, all those things happening, you know, during the pandemic. And I believe that, you know, God was still working during the pandemic. During the exile. God had prophets who were speaking. People like Daniel rose up and said that he was not going to be influenced by the Babylonian culture, and he was going to maintain the things that he had been taught. There were people who stood strong during the exile. And so we can talk to people about life during the pandemic and how we can still experience God and how we can still see God at work in our lives. The second thing that has arisen, you know, during the summer has been this whole thing about racial reconciliation. And I heard many things on the news. I saw so many things on Facebook, so many things on social media about racial reconciliation. And I thought to myself, you know what? We have the answer. The gospel has the answer. It is the answer for the issue about racial reconciliation. Early on, you know, right after George Floyd had been killed, I invited a friend of mine, an African-American friend of mine, to speak for our congregation. And he talked about some of his own experiences in that he's had to deal with. And on that day, I asked him to serve the communion with me. And, you know, we do communion online, but he and I did the communion together. And then a couple of weeks later was Father's Day. And I had another African-American friend of mine help me do the Father's Day message. And he talked about the plight of the African-American family and the things that they had to face. But you see, the gospel has the answers that we're seeking in racial reconciliation. That day that we offered the communion, this is what I told our congregation. I said, when Jesus instituted the Last Supper, and if you looked around the room, Jesus was the only one in that room who was not a racist. Everybody else, you know, all the other disciples were racist. They were racist against the Samaritans. They were racist against the Gentiles. It was just a way of life. Jesus was the only one who was not a racist. And see, Jesus is the one who can bring wholeness and who can restore relationships and bring about the reconciliation that we're looking for. And so if you have friends who are wondering about what's going on with race relations, if they're wondering, you know, how to speak into that, that's a conversation you can have because the gospel speaks into racial reconciliation. And then AACF staff last Saturday, we sat in on a training for mental illness because we hear about a rise in suicides. We hear about rises in anxiety and depression right now. I have a couple students in my church who are dealing with depression, and it's largely based on the pandemic. And yet, you know, we have the opportunity to speak into those concerns. You know, we can counsel, we can speak with, and most of all, we can be with people who are going through some of these anxieties, some of these issues right now. I remember going through seminary and taking the pastoral care classes, and I go, okay, great. I'm gonna learn everything that you say to someone when they're stressed out, when they've lost a loved one, when they're going through a divorce. They're gonna give me all the answers. And you know what? They didn't tell me a thing. They didn't give me any answers. And the reason is because there are no answers. There's no magic word that you can say to make people feel better. But what you can do is you can be with people. You can come alongside. You can talk with them. You can let them talk. You can listen to their anxiety and their fears. You can be a light to a person who is just having a really difficult time right now. And you can be the person who offers that companionship. You can offer the presence of God to them during this time of the pandemic. And, you know, of course, there's the gospel in Jackbox. And that sounds really strange, but we're going to do this for our regional AACF in a few weeks. Sometimes people just need some time to hang out. They need some time to be together. And I don't know where we get this idea that only Christians like to play Jackbox. But you know, when you if you do something like Jackbox, you know, think about a non-Christian friend that you can invite to be a part of that. So many times when we start thinking about things to share the gospel, we get a little anxious because we think, oh no, you know, now I got to carve out another day where I'm sharing the gospel. I got to have this time set aside, you know, where I can do that. But you know, all you have to do is to invite people to participate in things that you're already doing. And if you have something like a game night, a Jackbox night, just invite people along and just let them experience the fellowship. Let them experience the community. Let them be a part of things that are going on at Cal Poly. So yeah, the gospel and Jackbox. All right, now there are some issues that transcend the pandemic. Last week for our regional group, we had a friend of mine speak, and he's living in Hong Kong. He's a missionary over there. And I think it's the first time we've had a speaker for an AACF that was in Hong Kong. But it was pretty amazing because he was talking about missions that night, but he did it in the context of his own story and how God led him to go to Hong Kong, him and his wife and his two kids. And he just started talking about all the things that were personal to him. And it amazed me how much our students were tracking with that. They just really enjoyed hearing from him. They were really touched by the things that he said. And it showed me something. It showed me that there are some issues that are not caused by the pandemic. These are issues that are always there. And sometimes we forget about that during the pandemic. We just start thinking about COVID things. But there are these personal issues that affect people, whether there's a pandemic or not. And I think the pandemic just increases the way that we feel about these things. And so, you know, first of all, the gospel and my personal relationships. Some people feel like they either don't have friends or they can't make friends, or maybe they're losing friends during the pandemic. Again, you know, how can we come alongside somebody and talk to them about that? Give them some feedback. Let them talk. Give them some feedback. Let them talk some more. They're talking about the personal relationships that go on, because a lot of times, you know, it's with friends. Sometimes it's with family. The person's working. Sometimes it's working relationships. But people need a place. They need an outlet to discuss those things. And what better place can there be than to do it in the context of the gospel? Yeah, the gospel and my personal struggles. I met one student. He's the only one who has said this so far. He was, I won't say what school he's from. But I was talking to him in the spring. And he says, you know, I kind of actually like these classes on Zoom. You like the classes on Zoom? And he goes, yeah, you have to understand, I'm an ultra introvert. And being around people, you know, just really scares me. And he said, being on Zoom, he can be by himself, and it's like him and a professor, the professor just talking to him. And he said, yeah, I'm really comfortable with this. He's the only one, you know, that I've heard say that. You know, everybody else is telling me, you know, that they really struggle. They really miss seeing people. They miss the interaction. They miss the closeness. I heard one student a couple weeks ago saying, you know, I think we're doing an icebreaker, and we were asking people what their love language was. And he said his love language is personal contact. And he said he's a hugger. And it's really bad for him right now during the pandemic because he can't touch anybody. So yeah, you know, we can enter into those conversations. We can talk about the loneliness. We can talk about the anxiety. We can talk about the struggles that people are having with classes. You know, why is it you find your class boring? Is there a better way to learn? Is there a better way to do this Zoom stuff? Yeah, you know, we can bring the gospel message into conversations about personal struggles. Yeah, and then this guy last week, you know, he was talking about his purpose in life. And when he was talking about his purpose in life, I'm thinking to myself, wow, you know, I think we forgot all about that during the pandemic. Because purpose in life is something that's kind of in the distance. It's out in the future. And we're just so engrossed with the pandemic right now. But yeah, he was talking about his time when he was in college and when he was wondering about what his life was about and what his purpose was. And I could see students on the screen, you know, they're kind of nodding their heads and, you know, is something that they maybe had not talked about or thought about during the pandemic. And, you know, here is this guy, you know, bringing it up, and it allowed people to think. And, you know, we can ask questions of people. Well, what do you think God has in store for you? You know, why did God create you? Why did God make you? But what is it that God has in store for you in your life? So, yeah, you know, we can bring that up. And of course, you know, the gospel and my relationship with God. I don't think we necessarily need to take out a gospel track and share it with somebody during the pandemic. I don't think it's a sales presentation that people are looking for. I think people are wondering, you know, where is God? What is God doing? What is God saying? What is God saying to me? You know, how can I know God more? So, yeah. You know, we can save those tracks for another time. But I think during the time of the pandemic, people would just like to know God. They would like to know who he is. They'd like to know what he can do in their lives. So, I want to take us to the story in John 4 about the woman at the well. And it's an interesting story because, you know, it's a story about racism. It says there at the very beginning that Jesus had to go through Samaria. And the ironic thing was nobody had to go through Samaria. Everybody avoided Samaria. And yet in writing the gospel, John says, Jesus had to go through Samaria. And he goes to this town, Sychar, and Jesus does a bunch of no-nos there. You know, first thing is he talks to a Samaritan. He talks to a Samaritan who is a woman. He talks to a Samaritan woman who is not a very good type of woman. And yeah, Jesus is just breaking all these rules that, you know, rabbis are not supposed to do. And it's the only time in the Bible, only time in the Gospels, where I can see that the disciples went into town to buy food and they brought it back out. It's the only time in the Gospels where I see takeout food. And that was because the disciples would dare not eat in town with Samaritans. And they had to go in and buy certain kinds of dry food and bring it back out and eat it by themselves. And so Jesus said, okay, yeah, go get the food. But he speaks to this woman. And if you trace that conversation with the woman, you can find elements of the things that I just mentioned in the previous slide. You know, Jesus talked to her about her personal relationships. She didn't bring it up. You know, Jesus knew. You've had five husbands and the man you're living with now is not your husband. Oh, well, let's talk about where we should worship. You know, she quickly changes the topic. See, Jesus has pierced into her life and has brought up the issue of, you know, her personal relationships and, you know, how difficult that must be for her. The stress, the hurt that must have come from having those different relationships. And then, you know, her personal struggles. The fact that she had to come out at noontime to draw water because she didn't want to be with the other women in town because they would call her names, they would talk about her. It was just not very pleasant. And it was a hard thing for her to have to come out alone at noontime to draw water. And yeah, I put in parentheses here, lamenting, because I think that's something that we have not made a lot of room for during the pandemic, that people need to lament. People need to express themselves. People need to tell others how they're hurting. And there's not very many outlets for that. And what better place for someone to express their grief than someone who has a personal relationship with Jesus himself? Yeah, and then, you know, Jesus also talks about her purpose in life because he talks about, you know, who he is as the Messiah. And, you know, immediately she runs into town and she tells others that she's found someone who she thinks is the Messiah. And amazingly, you know, this woman had a reputation, but amazingly, the people in the town listened to her and they came back out to the well to find out for themselves. And so Jesus, in the midst of all this, was transforming the purpose in this woman's life. And of course, yeah, her relationship with God, because Jesus is inviting her to taste the living water that does not run dry. And Jesus is doing a work of transformation in her life. So we share the gospel by living the gospel. Yeah, a lot of times, you know, we share the words, but, you know, especially during the pandemic, you know, people are looking for others who have something different, who have something extra, who offer something that the rest of the world does not have. And we have the opportunity to step into that. And I don't know what you're thinking about as I'm giving this talk here, but I'd like you to think about people that you know. Now, how can you step into their lives? I think a lot of times we're afraid to do that because we think we're being offensive. We think that we might be going into sacred territory that you know, they don't want us to go into. But, you know, I tell people, we need to respect our non-Christian friends. And what I mean by that is we need to give them the chance to say no. You know, so many times we say no for them before even giving the invitation. We need to respect their opinion. If they want to say no, you know, they can say no. But invite them into something that you're doing. You know, I don't know what other things you guys are doing as AECF, if you're doing other things besides the large group, if there are men's groups or women's group, or if you have Bible studies that are going on. You know, think about somebody that you can invite to be a part of that and see, you know, what happens. You know, see if it's something, you know, they may be just looking for something different that they can do that nobody else has talked about during these past 7 months.
Father, just thank you so much for this large group. Yeah, thank you for your gospel and yeah, that we get to share it, that you use us to spread it to other people, to yeah, teach them what it means to in relationship with you, and to so yeah, I just pray that we would be able to do that despite current circumstances. And yeah, I pray for our worship right now that, yeah, you would just you would make your presence known to us, and that we would be able to be unified in our worship, despite not being unified in location. Yeah, thank you so much, and pray that this worship would be pleasing to you, and pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small, child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me.
Father, I just want to tell you that We are so moved by your love for us. And just to thank you, God, for loving people like us. And in the discussion questions, we were talking about like having a relationship with you and having a purpose in life through you. And I'm just reminded, God, of how sweet that relationship is and how worth it it is. And Lord, I thank you that having relationship with you wasn't easy. It was at a cost, but that you still paid that cost. And I pray that every single day and every moment we could live our lives acknowledging that fact, God, and living in the grace that you have shown us, that undeserved grace. And I pray that we could live in joy and victory because of that grace as well. I thank you for these brothers and sisters that we can run the race together with. And I thank you, Lord, that your love is unconditional and so perfect. I love you so much, God. We love you. And in your son's name I pray. Amen. Amen.
And now we're moving on to announcements. Thank you, worship team, for playing Jesus Paid It All. I appreciate it. My name is Peter, and my co-host is Danielle. We're both food science majors, and just introduce ourselves. So the mission in AACF is to reach into the collegiate community to... dang it, I don't have this memorized.
Come on, Peter!
I'm trying. Primarily to those who are Asian, Pacific American, blah, 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 blah. You don't have to be Asian or Asian Christian or any of those. So, yeah, we welcome you and thank you for coming to our large group.
Our theme for this year is Chesed, and our theme verse is 1 John 3:16, not John 3:16, but 1 John 3:16. It's, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. And our focus this quarter is the gospel, what the gospel means, and yeah, that's fall.
So if you don't know, we have something called prayer groups. Prayer groups is where we get to just spend time in a small group, about five or less people, where you get to pray for the prayer topic that are listed out each week, usually posted on Mondays, and then you get to just personally pray for one another and be intentional in each other's lives. So I'm in one currently, and I've been in the past, and it's been really a great experience. And if anything, besides large groups or Bible studies, this is the thing to go to, because it's an easy way for you to get plugged in and just get to know a small group of people without feeling overwhelmed, and a great time of just prayer, because prayer is so important in our lives. So yeah, please join one. The QR code is in the slide, so just scan that and then you'll be able to sign up, and we'll plug you in one.
We also have book club going on. This is something that's new this year, but I've never gone, but I've heard it's very fun. And I think they're starting a new book, The Magician's Nephew. If you're wondering how that relates to the gospel, then you should go to book club. And if you need access to the book, I think you can ask Connor, but yes. Oh, I forgot to mention, it's on Saturday at 7 p.m.
Yeah, you'll find it in our Facebook group, somewhere in the announcements. So, as I said earlier, we have Bible studies. They happen every Tuesday over Zoom at 7 p.m. For those of you who can make it on time, and 8 p.m. for those of you who need to come late. So we basically try to make it as adjusted as possible. So just go to our Facebook page. Honestly, our Facebook page is usually the best way for you to get connected and to keep up with events. other than that, we later on we will have a QR code area where you can sign up for things like Bible study, so you can still be connected through our emailing list and so forth.
Sign up for Moys, or you can just ask anyone. Yeah, Moys are a great way to get to know someone a little bit better. It's just a one-on-one time where you can have an intentional conversation. You can talk about anything. A lot of the times people share testimonies, but you don't have to, but it's always a great time, so you should definitely have Moys.
So we have many churches that most of us go to. We all do not go to one specific one because we are made up of many believers who prefer different types of styles of church. So we have Vista, Shoreline Journey, Calvary Grace, and so many more. So you might be going to your home church back home, or you might be going to one in person here, or just looking at virtually while in slow. So those are the QR codes to get to the website so you can learn more about them and such. And as we all say every week, AACF is not a replacement for church.
Now is time for introductions. If there's anyone new here,
is Peter just wielding him?
Yes.
Oh. Okay, I think everybody here has been here before, but if you're new to our fellowship, you can, or you should definitely fill out the newcomer form, which is, if you scan the QR code, that will link you to it.
Sorry to interrupt Danielle, but I was saying how earlier we had our Facebook group. That is the easiest way for you to get in contact with us. We also have Instagram, and we have a website. Our website is www.acfslow.org. It's really cool. You should go take a look at it because it's better than most websites I've seen out there, to be honest. You should go check it out, just see what we're about, and make sure that you keep up to date with everything we do, because whenever we do post something, you should want to be in the know, so to keep up with anything we're doing virtually, since we can't do anything in person. So yeah.
Links, if you need them, they're over there.
As for next week's large group, stay tuned. As I said, keep up to date with our Facebook and Instagram to keep up to date, so you'll know and that you can always show up to our large groups and stuff. Sidebar, we have a YouTube channel. I don't think that's shown here, but it's AACF Slow. Pretty easy to figure out. Subscribe to the channel, obviously, because we post our large groups with our messages and stuff. So I just posted the one that was 2 weeks ago, and it features Jackie and Michelle. So if you haven't watched that, it's a great message. So you should see what it's all about.